Hallelujah. Father, we pray that there would not be one single person in this place that does not understand how to let your love flow through them. Hallelujah. Father, we pray that there will not be one person in this place that doesn't understand how to let your encouragement flow through them, how to let your joy flow through them, how to let your refreshing flow through them, even though they may have been up all night working on one calculus problem or whatever. Hallelujah. Because, Lord, you're not relegated by all of those things that we make important. You're not going to be prioritized because our body is tired or because our mind is weak or whatever. Ha. But, Lord, when we just put you in first place, you take over in every place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we pray that every person in here would be willing to obey one single verse of Scripture. Rejoice evermore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Manjeseya. Hallelujah. 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 More people are going to give their life because of your rejoicing. More people are going to give their life to Jesus because of your rejoicing than anything else. They watch you and they measure you. You don't realize that they're measuring you. I got this little thing that monitors how far I run, how fast I run every day. They measuring you at their little monitoring system. They see how many times out of a week you happy and how many times out of the week you sad. And it's ultimately going to work out to where they're not. They're going to listen to anything you got to say. Huh? It's true. People are looking for happy and they're looking for love. Amen. Yes. And probably looking at that order. Huh? Similar to that order. And both love and happy got to be at the same time. You never believe anybody love you when they're telling you with a frown. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. He would say, well, you know, I'm not sure that the smile is normal. We all know it's normal. Because as soon as we see you with a sad or anybody, no matter how profane they are, they know something's wrong. That's right. That means something's not normal. Are you with me? Something's out of place. So we want you to learn how to participate with the Holy Spirit in very simple ways. Because if you can't, you're not going to move on. You know, you're going to have to just learn how to participate with him very simply. Hallelujah. And somebody says, well, I just don't have nothing to be happy about. Well, then we want you to be saved and born again and come into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And you're going to be so full of joy. You'll have more to be happy about than it'll take you all eternity to express how happy you are. And once you get, you know, having your names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you just see your name. Say, Lord, show me my name again. Can I see my name in there one more time? Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was talking to a group of young men one day, and I was asking each one of them, do you know your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life? And one, you know, they kept saying, well, the Lord knows. And my response was, he wants you to know. It's not good enough just whether he knows or not. You need to know. Otherwise, if you don't know you're right with God, then you're not. If you don't know what Father's will is for your life, then you're never really going to participate with it. Hallelujah. And what I got to say, you can only receive by the Spirit anyways.
Amen.
And if there's not even a flow of the Holy Ghost, you're going to get probably 10% of what I say. And the stronger that adeki nabosikaya is, the more you'll be able to receive. And you'll know what you received because it will be an outworking. And I'm a pastor. I realize I got to speak to people sometimes many, many years before they ever receive it. I know when they receive it, there's an outworking. I've seen people come and inside of 1 week be touched by God in such a way that a dozen people give their life to Jesus. The outworkings of things happen in their life in 1 week that hasn't happened in people's life in 20 years. It's not relegated by time. It's really the response of your heart. It really, some people have spent a lifetime of resistance, of rebellion, of things that, you know, the enemy was able to fortify in their life when they were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And they really don't understand how to move forward with God when they're born in righteousness to be shaped in purity. They don't really know how to submit themselves. They don't know how to trust God. They don't know how to really just depend upon him. And so they spend a lot of their life learning this, those basic things. And sometimes You find other people, they step right in. They have no problem trusting. They don't have no problem believing. They have no problem just submitting to the word and running with it. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful. Other people, they'll come in to begin to have a move of God in their life. And then what will happen is it hits a bump in the road, fall into the ditch of discouragement. Huh? And then they walking around with their head hanging down. I got a remedy for that. Just go start reading the word again. Yes. Amen. Get yourself a fresh vision. Praise God. Amen. I'll tell you right now, what's real in God can't ever get derailed. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Tastakoto Mositiya. Well, I saw a lot more people upstairs than there are down here. I don't know what's happened to them. Kind of waiting for them. I reckon they didn't need the school of the Spirit. Or they had other things they did. They need the school of the Spirit. I don't know why, where you can't prioritize God. I mean, I'm happy for every one of you that are here. But you know what? You're not going to prioritize God and go on with God. You're not. You're going to stay right. You're going to limit yourself. Some people say, what do I must do to grow fast in the kingdom of God? Well, that's right. There's the good heart to have, to grow fast in the relationship. Well, if you're asking those questions, you're probably going to basically be in most of the meetings. And then other folks have got other things they need to do. And, you know, don't make other things important to you. Not when there's an opportunity for you to receive things that come right out of heaven. And, you know, and the church service, the meeting where God anoints us to preach and minister, is the means by which the Holy Spirit begins to do work in our lives in response to our commitment, begins to make adjustments that there then put the mantle on you. And I want you to be able to hear tonight and understand a little bit about how easy it is to pick up the mantle and then begin. As soon as you pick up the mantle, you can begin to do the work of the ministry that only the mantle can give you, okay? The mantle representing really an office, and the office representing an authority to function without, really, in many respects, without a limit within that office or that anointing. And so, one of the great examples of that would be Elijah and his mantle representing his office as a prophet, okay? And so he threw his mantle over upon Elisha, and Elisha had to come and learn how to serve the man of God. And that's the way this is what we're seeing here is we're seeing the nature of heaven, the nature of how it works. There's no circumventing it. It happens the same way. It's very reproducible. Those who participate with it get it. Those who don't get it. Or it's prolonged and protracted. And sometimes people just get so frustrated, they become so overwhelmed that finally they say, you know what, I'm going to wash the hands of the man of God. And so that's what Elisha was known as. He was known as the man who washed the hands of Elijah. You know, somebody said, oh, you just go over there and you get controlled by Elijah and you just become his yes man and you got all of his dirty work and he doesn't really care about you. He doesn't really consider the fact that you really had a lot going for you and you had a great business and enterprise until all of a sudden that mantle opportunity came your way and then you went ahead and in obedience and consecration, surrender to God, you know, you basically sold your business and had a big barbecue and ate your oxen, and here you are years later and you're still just standing there in the background, and the man of God needs his hands washed. He turns around, puts out his hands, and that's your cue to get the towel out and pour the water. And that's all you get to do. You don't get to practice nothing. You don't get to say nothing. Never get a turn. Sometimes he doesn't even look at you. And then he gets to the point, place where he's saying, I wish you would go away. What is it you want from me anyways? And you won't even go away when he looks at you like that. Because there's something you want. There's a desire of your heart. There's a hunger. And you listen, I'm telling you, God, the Holy Ghost, speaks to us through these things. We look at Joshua and we see how he served Moses. I don't believe that Joshua ever had one thought in his head that he one day he would take Moses' place or that he would be anything more than what he was. He fell in love with the anointing. He fell in love with the presence. He fell in love with the glory. That was what was unique about him. I believe what was unique about Elisha was he also fell in love with the presence. He fell in love with the glory. He fell in love with the anointing. And I can see it and I hear it, especially when Elijah says, well, what do you want from me? He said, I want double of what you got. I understand his love for the glory. I understand his love for the presence and for the anointing. It was the reason, the motivation for why he was able and willing to invest his whole life into the possibility of having this. Possibility of having this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It wasn't a foregone conclusion just because the call of God was upon their life. I've seen many people with the call of God upon their life, they never fulfilled the call because it is mixed in with your will. It's mixed in with your hunger. It's mixed in with your willing to obey God. And the Holy Spirit wants to lead us. The school of the Spirit is all about us learning how to lead, that be led by the Holy Ghost. But the Holy Ghost is going to lead us to do what God said in his word for us to do. He's going to bring into remembrance what God said in his word for us to do. He's always going to be leading us and empowering us to do the word. And when we're willing to get that, when we're willing to begin to understand that the Lord Jesus, like Elijah, dropped his mantle for anyone who wants to pick it up. He didn't just make it. He didn't just throw the mantle over on one person. He made it available to whosoever wills. He's thrown the mantle there. And some people, like Elijah, is willing to pay whatever price is necessary to pay. There's nothing more important to them. There's nothing that they desire more. You can see it in the way that they serve in the ministry. You can see it in their passion and their love and their excitement. When they encounter other people and they begin to talk about the greatest and most wonderful thing in their life. Who is this? Who is this most wonderful and greatest thing in their life? The Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost, the things that has been brought down from heaven. Our Heavenly Father, you see it in them. You see it in the way that they give in the offering. They see it in the way they give in their sacrifice of their life. And it's that way with everybody in the Bible. And the word of God is delivered to us that we may have these examples, that we may come to understand the wisdom and the insight and the revelation that God gave. And he gave to men like Enoch. He gave to men like Elijah. And that he revealed through their lives so that you and I could follow them being examples to them. There were more than 500 brethren that seen Jesus go up. I mean, you talk about a supernatural, faith-building, supercharged event. Watching Jesus ascend up into heaven. After that, he's been raised up from the dead. You're standing there looking at the one that you knew in the flesh, and now you know him after the Spirit in his eternal glory, standing there. And now he's gone up into heaven. Now you've got angels coming down and say, "What men? Oh, men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? With this same Jesus who you've seen go up will return in like manner." Get busy, basically what they were saying. And Jesus just before he went up, he said, "I'm going to drop the mantle. The mantle's coming. I'm going to send the promise of the Father. And he's going, Dambodul Setea, baptizing in the Holy Ghost and fire, unlimited." I mean, Elijah couldn't even have that. Imagine how Elisha couldn't have had that either, asking for double of what Elijah had. Imagine what Elisha would have done if he could have had the opportunity to have what you and I have. I mean, we're here in the School of the Spirit here tonight, and I believe we get our eyes off on our own imagination and our own thinking. There are three categories of which you can live your life. You can live your life purely in the Word of God, and you don't need to be educated. That, I mean, my goodness, you just be like a little simple baby. In fact, the more simple you are, the more you'll be able to do it. And because it is not in much knowledge, it's rather in much doing. Hallelujah. It's just in simply willing to participate with God. You can either be one who lives by the Word, and the Word of God is all that you want, and that's all that counts, and you read it and you do it. Or you can be a person who's taken the Word of God and mixed it with tradition, and mixed it with philosophy, and mixed it with ideology, and mixed it with your, you know, just as bad, your own opinion of what you believe and what you think and how you can figure it out and how you perceive. I learned a long time ago, do not try to think the Bible through. Because I read that scripture one day, Peter talking about Paul's ministry, said they wrestled the scripture to their own destruction. I said, I'm not wrestling nothing. You know, if I don't understand something, I'm going to let God reveal it to me by his Spirit. Hallelujah. And then I discovered in that commitment that he came and revealed his, these things to me. Revelation just come to me, just drop out of my, drop into my heart, just out of nowhere. Where I wasn't even thinking about it. Boom, just drop right into my heart, and I would understand the, scriptures, and I'd understand the word, and then you know, as time went on, you know, that became even that much more solidified in my life. I didn't try to think through nothing, diagram nothing, step by step anything. You know what? Just leave it to God. Let the Holy Ghost be the revelator, because that's who He is. Learning how to depend upon the Holy Ghost is the chief and most important thing for you and me, because the Holy Ghost is better than Elijah. One yes, one true, one happy, three smiles, five frowns. You know, he wants to become the real living person that He is to our lives. He wants to be our teacher. He wants us to respond at least as good as Elisha did to Elijah. But reality of it is, He deserves a whole lot more response and a whole lot more honor than Elijah ever did. We just don't know how to fit Him into the framework of our life, because we prioritize things. We've made things our society and culture and influences and peers have made other things far more important to us than following the Holy Ghost and recognizing that He's here and understanding who He is. But with the school of the Spirit, it's all about you really giving yourself just by an act, just by the act of being here. You're saying, Holy Ghost, I want to be in your school. I mean, I started this meeting because I was in Japan, and I had people sitting in Japan saying, please don't leave Japan. Please stay with us so that we can learn about more about the Holy Ghost. And it was so sad to me. I had to leave. The Lord had given me no release to stay in Japan. And I thought, my goodness gracious, I'm going to go home and start a school of the Spirit on their behalf. And praise God, they watch it in Japan, and they watch the YouTubes. Hallelujah. Because that was the best I could do for Japan. But you know what? I want to see God's people have it here now too. I want to see you hear the word, see you receive the word of God, and not be forgetful hearers, or not be as those who heard the word but it wasn't mixed with faith, and so they never did it, and it didn't profit you. I want to see every time that when these riches go forth, there's a profit, that there's an increase. God wants fruit. He wants profit. God's in for profit. Hallelujah. He wants profit. He wants returns on His investment. Hallelujah. Praise God. He wants fruit. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, he goes to a place, he looks and goes, I don't see the fruit. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? Huh? And then he gets to the place even where he said, you know, he comes now to a tree, and really it is not even the time of fruit, it's just time of green leaves. And he said, cursed is this tree. And immediately it withers away. No man eats fruit from you forever. I'm taking the fruit, your opportunity, your ministry chance, your ministry opportunity. I'm taking it away from you and I'm giving it to another. God does this. It's an act of dimension. And I'll tell you right now, I fear and tremble over it. I'm like, the worst thing I could possibly imagine is, Lord, that somehow my ministry opportunity would be taken from me, somehow the anointing would be taken from me, somehow His manifest presence would be taken from me. I'm telling you right now, I'm not in fear about it, but I guarantee you, Papa hears it from my voice coming out of my mouth probably every day saying, Lord, I've got to have more. Father, the worst thing I could possibly ever imagine is somehow I've taken you for granted. Somehow I've missed you, and I've done the things that are grieving you. God, help me. And good thing is that the Holy Spirit's here to lead us and guide us, and just works within me a greater consecration, a greater submission, you know, a greater, Lord, all that I have is yours. I mean, I'll take my boots and everything else off right now and just give it to you, whatever. There's nothing. I mean, naked you came in this world, be certain. Naked you're going out of this world. And all that's going to be there. Father's not going to be impressed with anything that you did. No degrees that you got. No things that you built. No money that you gave. No money that you earned. No money that you have. What all that's going to be important to Him is the relationship you had with Him. And the Word of God features to us the fruits of the relationship. So we do these things, the things that we do. It's not because we have to or by constraint. It's the overflow of just surrender to Him. Hallelujah. And then, my goodness, you get to step over into the glory realm. Hallelujah. So we want you to understand fundamental things about the school of the Spirit. And when God says to do something, you just begin to do it. I'm going to tell you right now, when Jesus first spoke to the disciples, the 12 disciples, which you can read about it in Matthew chapter 10, and I want you to look at this real quickly with me, Matthew chapter 10 and also Luke chapter 9, and When he says this to the disciples, he wasn't like they weren't practicing, you know. And he's like, he's praying for people, and he'd say, "Oh, come over here, Peter, give me your hand. Let's lay it over here on this guy's head." And they stood and watched him. They stood there and ministered to him. In fact, Jesus, I don't even know, Jesus didn't even, you know, give us any indication that he knew who the apostles that he was going to separate unto himself. He had a great company of people following him until that day that he went up into the mountain to pray, that we read about here in Matthew chapter 10. And he comes down, and the scripture says he called unto his 12 disciples, and he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. They got the mantle. See, he gave them the mantle. But he gave them the mantle only in part to function under the authority that he himself at that time was administering, and was telling them about a day that they were going to step into even a greater unlimited authority that would come to them by the Holy Ghost. And so then what he does is he gives them this authority, and then he sends them out and he tells them to go and heal the sick. Listen, dear people, it was just the confidence that would come from the word of God, or the word that was spoken by the Lord Jesus, and the confidence that would have come from watching him do it and the results that he got, that then inspired them to go ahead and do what he told them to do. I believe that when you're touched with the fire of God and the presence of the Holy Ghost on the level and measure, especially of that which Jesus described. Remember, John baptized with water, but you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. Verse 5, Acts 1. When he said, "You shall receive power after that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, proof providers unto all of Jerusalem, Judea, and uttermost parts of the earth." I understand, I believe this, that they immediately went with a great encouragement and excitement on the inside of them, which just simply built as they went from one case, one situation to the next. And that's what God has called us to give our lives fully to, no matter where we're at, no matter what kind of vocation we're in, what kind of work we're in, what kind of activity we're in. I love hearing some of my friends talk about how many people got saved when they finally took enough time off to take a vacation. Brother Young is describing to me, you know, they hadn't taken a vacation in 2 years. They take a vacation and the whole hotel gets saved. You know, because that's just who he is. He's in vacation. I'm laying hands on the sick and excited about Jesus and telling people that how much the Lord Jesus Christ loves them, and being happy about it, and having a vocabulary that I'm not ashamed of. I mean, in the midst of all the wicked people, I'm still, praise God, thank you, Lord Jesus, Holy Ghost. I mean, I'm just there, you know. And they have their vocabulary, whatever. I got my vocabulary. They have anything to ask me about my vocabulary, it's an open door to give them some more information. Hallelujah. Praise God. I mean, you know. When people give you good news, they're not just saying, that's really cool, that's wrong. You got the wrong vocabulary. That was your opportunity to open up, to begin to declare the name of Jesus, which has an authority on it. When you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you just say Jesus, and the place just mowed down. I mean, every devil in hell just left the place as soon as you said Jesus, whether you recognize it or not. But the more you read the Bible, the more you get caught away in relationship with him, the more real this is, and the more real it is, the more reality begins to become, you know, apparent to you of what's actually happening when you go, thank you, Lord Jesus. Somebody gives you good news. Boss gives you good news. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Somebody said, "Well, I want to cast my pearls before swine." That's a misappropriation. That's different proclamation. Hallelujah. The Lord told you and me, he just simply said this, I give you power. Now go and preach the gospel to every creature. Hallelujah. Go give them the good news. Praise God. This is the school of spirit. If you do not do it, you will not grow. If you do not do it, you will not develop. You'll be stuck. And somebody said, "I'm stuck. I'm fearful. I'm overwhelmed. I'm self-conscious. I feel intimidated." Well, you need to pray through. It's what the old timers used to call it. You need to pray through. Hallelujah. Because I'm telling you, a person was sharing with me the other night, and she was saying, wow, I got so touched in the meeting. And she said, you know, when the result of that, she said, I just felt this amazing love. I love everybody. I like everybody. But I just felt this amazing love for just everybody, just overwhelming love for everybody. I said, that's it. That's where we're supposed to live. I mean, I have that every meeting. You should have that every meeting. It would be great if people didn't have that at the end of the meeting. Hallelujah. When everything's been run off because the word of God's gone forth. But you have it at the beginning of the meeting. I've learned to move past everything Satan does and everything hindering spirits would do, which is what is the only thing that keeps us from the flow of the Holy Ghost outside of our own unwillingness to participate with God. Because I discovered a long time ago that I can have a move of God anytime I want it, because He's always moving and He wants it to be that way. He wants rivers flowing out. And so I've learned how to break through and have a great move of God, whether in prayer or whether in singing or whether in preaching. Come on, people. I'm telling you right now. The Father has given us so many wonderful weapons, the weapons of our warfare, which are not carnal but mighty. The Word of God is one of the great weapons. Prayer is one of the great, all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. I mean, building yourself up in most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Wow, the name of Jesus, what a weapon. And of course, you know, Wednesday night, and then of course Sunday night. Sunday night, Wednesday night, we've had two meetings just on the table. And just on the blood and the communion. And of course, it's a series that's going to continue on now for a while. But the application of the blood of Jesus Christ that gives to us the authority ultimately to execute the name of Jesus. Walking in this authority, the name of Jesus. And of course, if you want to grab a hold of and get stirred up, I'm telling you right now, I can read this book and get so stirred with faith and learn so much, and the Lord used me to write it. I'm telling you right now, what can happen with you? And if people see what happened, distractions come, you're just too busy, and then you're wondering why you're too sour. Huh? You weren't in the right kind. You're sour if you don't stay in the right environment. Yeah. All right, you won't stay sweet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, the unlimited authority of God. Do you have this? Here, you have it now. Hand that to Troy. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Robo sikiste perisha. Hallelujah. Pandora sikinasi. Thank you, Jesus. Just begin to give yourself to the study of the Word, especially on certain topics and subjects of faith, signs, wonders, and miracles. Just simply obeying God and preaching the gospel. Hallelujah. Start doing it. Start laying hands on everybody. As soon as you detect somebody sick, don't say, well, you know, I've got some aspirin in the car. First of all, you shouldn't even have any aspirin in the car. Somebody said, try and take away my aspirin. No, it should have already been done. You know, you shouldn't have all that other stuff. You don't need that stuff. Hallelujah. You need to pray through. Well, it's painful. You little baby. Little sissy. Why don't you learn? Come on. You can pray through that. We hope you don't ever get put in prison and have to suffer for the name of Jesus. And you don't have your Advil and Excedrin, you know, and Tylenol PM or whatever else it is you need. As you're getting thrashed and beaten for the name of Jesus. Come on, man. You can press through that stuff. You can press through your little bit of aggravation. Give me a break. You can press through some little depression. Come on. Give me a break. You can press through a sniffle and a cough. You can press through a toe ache and to ultimately discover that He'll bear you up in His hand so you won't even stub your toe. Because everything that applies to Jesus, He gave it over to us. It's our inheritance. Hallelujah. To have such good care. God takes such good care of us. Hallelujah. His siporanaya. He piti piti khan. His emusitante pika, His fetamorite, favor everywhere we go, His blessing everywhere we go. Hallelujah. Praise God. We needed a big old refrigerator. I mean, it's just the way it works. We needed one of those big, gigantic refrigerators. It cost about $8,000-$10,000, you know, because we got all of this, you know, first of our Wagyu beef coming in. And I woke up, I was laying in bed that morning and said, Lord, Father, I just thank you for a provision. I don't even know where to begin, but you know the beginning from the end. And you don't want me to know the beginning from the end. That's your department. You want me to just follow step by step. And I said, I thank you, Father, for your goodness. I thank you for your supply. I thank you for leading me and guiding me this day. I woke up. I walked to the breakfast table. I sat there and I opened up the computer. I turned to Craigslist. I put in refrigerator. There it is. 3 foot wide, 7 foot high, 8 foot long, $500.
Thank you, Lord.
Barely used. Barely used. Chris went and helped me get it. Hallelujah. Kanda say ya po kinda seat. Hallelujah. Brought it into the house, prayed the blessing of God over, thanked him for his mighty provision. Hallelujah. Man, he just gave me $7,500. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Thanking him that it's going to run longer than brand new ones run. Beautiful things. Stainless steel, 3 doors. Just, I mean, come on. Huh? And the guy said, the guy told me, I can't believe I've had this thing for a long time. He says, it's the greatest deal anybody could ever imagine. No one ever called on it.
Thank you, Lord.
Ah! You can't figure any of this stuff out. It's just walking with God. I don't have a problem. I've invalidated problems. They don't exist. I got solutions. I sidestep it. Next. You know, anytime problem tries to present, oh, what are we going to do? I don't have to. That's not my department. What we're going to do is I'm going to worship the Lord and thank him for his mighty provision. I'm going to walk in the Spirit. I'm going to walk in the Word. I'm going to walk in a place of trusting God, believing God. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, what if things got bad like Job? I do what I do. I outdo Job. Hallelujah. Because I got the Holy Ghost. Pakashi Poramande. I got Panadea. I got more than he had. Hallelujah. Thus there's more responsibility on my shoulders. To whom much is given, much is required. And as a watchman in God's house, I'm always telling people, you don't understand what you're doing. You've got a whole lot more required than what you are even coming up to. Measuring up to. You better get with the program. You better get off your crawl pace and start coming up here and running. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Because the Lord, if you didn't have any anointing and you in a Baptist church and didn't even believe in the Holy Ghost, you could crawl if you want, probably, and be okay. And the Lord holds somebody else responsible for your lack of power and your lack of authority and your lack of obedience and your lack of flow and your lack of provision. But come on, people, you up here in a place that you listen. Well, this the Lord didn't create this church to be a kindergarten in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
He didn't.
No.
He created this church to raise up young men and young women that would develop into fathers in the faith. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the mothers, and as Paul said, or John said, elect lady. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You better get with the program. You better start kicking up. Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Kicking out the pace a little bit.
Yes.
Praise the name of Jesus. I mean, goodness. If you've been following me on Facebook, you see all the things I've been posting, considering, Jesus and training the disciples for 3 years. And at his greatest moment of need, they all fell asleep. They're willing to die for him, but because they don't get it. They don't get it. They're not going to the cross the next morning. If they were going to the cross the next morning, they'd be all bug-eyed. But no, they don't even get it. Well, it's just like a little child walking with the father, and his legs are too short to keep pace. And the Lord said, the Lord just loved on him and said, sleep on, take your rest. It's done, let's go. And then he comes and he crowns us. He crowns us with his victory. Says, gives us the winner's crown. And we fell asleep. And he gives us the winner's crown. Hallelujah.
Amazing.
He's an amazing God. Well, but after that, the mantle fell. After that, they were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Guess what? The responsibility that was on Jesus' shoulders, you can now see it on Peter's shoulders. Huh? You can see it on Paul's shoulders. You can see that now there were those who were willing to take up the mantle. There was a lot of other people. They weren't. But there were those who were willing to take up the mantle. My goodness, what if all of God's people were willing to take up the mantle? I believe... I believe that there's a possibility that there would already we'd already be in the millennial reign of Christ. We may actually be in the new heaven and new earth by now, because it's been 2,000 years. So imagine if everybody would have taken up the mantle, the whole world would have been transformed by the power of God, because everybody took up the mantle and began to flow in the power and the person of Jesus Christ. And I believe that Father is waiting for that fruit. That's a big part of what's going on. And that fruit isn't going to come any other way than by your simple consecration and commitment to the person of the Holy Ghost. Jesus sent us another leader, another guide. We can't ignore him. We just want to ignore him. Just look at Jesus. Well, that's fine, but if you look at Jesus long enough, he's going to say, hey, you need to look at the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm here and he's there with you, and it's expedient for him to be with you, and you need to start recognizing him and listening to him and obeying him and let him teach you, because he's in you and with you, and the way I'm in you is by him. Amen. He dwells in us by the Spirit, which he's given to us, 1 John 3:24, right? Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, you know, it's good to get woken up, awakened. Because you get all happy, you get all full of the Holy Ghost, and you're going to start seeing people being touched by the power of God right, left, and center. They are just being happy and full of the Holy Ghost. And you're going to all of a sudden have yourself, hallelujah, a plan and a purpose and a vision in the kingdom of God that is just blessed. Because God's in charge. He's in charge of you. Now, I kind of want to show you how easy this is. Go over here. I want to show you how easy this is. Okay, ready? Mark chapter 9. Go to Mark chapter 9. I want to show you how easy this is. You with me?
Yes.
Verse 37. Jesus says, whosoever shall receive one of such little children in my name receives me. And whosoever shall receive me receives not me, but him that sent me. So he's just telling us this is how simple it is to get all that I am supplying. All that Father is supplying is that you've got to receive them like a little child would receive them. Are you listening?
Yes.
There can't be suspicion and criticism and schism and all the other ism. It's just a loving, open, receptive heart full of honor, no baggage, no offense, no hurts, no problems, no all this, demonic mess that ultimately ends up in an adult state. In a human being. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Which, of course, the blood of Jesus is supposed to wash all away, and the Holy Spirit is supposed to, you know, show us how to resist steadfastly in the faith. Now, so immediately, John says, Master, we saw one casting out devils, because it comes to mind. You know, God, the word comes, and you're like, I didn't receive him, right? Here's John.
Right.
Jesus said, you're supposed to receive him, and then you receive me, and you receive the Father, and here's somebody come in his name. He goes, conviction strikes him by the word. Uh-oh, I may be in trouble here. And he says, we saw someone casting out a devil in your name, and he followed not us, and we forbid him because he didn't follow us. Now, thinking about this, okay? Think about this. Woo! Just think about this. This guy just saw either Jesus, or I think my personal opinion is he saw one of the disciples cast out a devil using the name of Jesus, because I don't see Jesus ministering. I command you, devil, go in the name of Jesus. He wouldn't be saying that. Are you with me?
Yes.
Jesus didn't preach in his name, as it were. He preached in the Father's name. He didn't cast out devils in his name. So he would have had to have been watching Philip or Thomas or Peter or John going, in the name of Jesus, devil, go. And all he did was, I like that. I want to do that. Let's go. He didn't have a special laying on hands meeting. Some of you guys have had hands laid on you till you bald almost now. You know what I'm saying? You've had hands laid on you to the point that you started to hope deferreth make the heart sick. Some people got sick hearts. I go so many, situations where I look at people sick at heart. Somehow they became discouraged. I never became discouraged. Failure never discouraged me, because I wasn't all high and big on myself anyways. I was a failure before I started. So if it looks like I failed, nothing's new.
Right.
Hello. I'm not all high and built up on me. If I get a success, I feel like I just conquered it all.
Amen.
And it's all about God's success anyways, because I never took that part. God's part is to do the miracle. My part is to do the laying on of hands and proclaim the miracle. Hallelujah. But you get filled with the fire of God and you're going to start prophesying. Verse just recently telling me, man, I got so hit with the power of God, I just started prophesying over the situations that have been up against me, and I just felt such a force and authority. That's the way it works. Now, you have authority over the situation. Now, you changing it by a prophetic word rather than letting that circumstance or that situation now dominate you and imprison you, and now you its slave. I'm not going to be nobody's slave. Not when it comes to some demon power, some stupid little thing in this earth. I'm going to be Papa's slave. I'm going to do what he said. And he told you and me to be mighty. He told us to have all power. He gave us his authority. He said, I'm baptizing you in everything that heaven has. I believe that. I'm not going to make God a liar. I'm not going to be wishy-washy about it. And I tell you right now, you can never, ever transfer that which you don't practice. You can never give that which you don't practice. You can never give it. And until you begin to practice it continually and ongoing, it is never going to be a breakthrough moment where you say, this is mine, God has given to me, and this defines who I am. This is what I was born to be and born to do. And it becomes every day practice of your life. And the more you participate with anything, the better you get at it. The more you do anything, the stronger you become at it. I mean, people say, I want to love more. Well, hug more people and tell them that you love them. It's really that simple. Well, I didn't feel nothing when I did it. And I've been doing it now for 10 years. Well, you got some serious problems. We need to get you in a prayer meeting, cast the devil out of you. You're oppressed by an evil spirit. Because somebody comes along, people come along all the time and try to say that, make a comment as though that their comment is going to result in that I'm going to believe the word of God differently now. Goodness gracious. Hey, man, go stand in line. More mightier than you have already come to me and tell me God's word doesn't work, beginning with Satan and all his devils. Give me a break. His word works. What? You're not a data point to prove that God's not faithful and he hasn't established his faithfulness in the heavens and his mercy endures forever and the covenant that he make, he will not break. Come on. That somehow his word is altered and somehow it fits everybody but you. Give me a break. You're looking at the wrong measurement. You've never stepped out of the doubt and into the faith. Because I'm telling you right now, people can sit around and watch faith work and miracle power work and signs and wonders work, and they can't see nothing. You can see it in the Bible. You can see it even in the ministry of Jesus. I mean, come on. If you can sit around the ministry of Jesus and not see anything, can't see the power of God, can't see miracles, can't see faith, can't see heavenly provision, come on. Then, goodness gracious, you can't find a more anointed preacher. Are you with me? And I've watched it happen all the time. I've watched it happen through my life, growing up in church. I've watched people sit around, has no discernment in the things of the Spirit. Why? They never gave themselves to the things of the Spirit. They let Satan run interference. And as soon as you do, I'm going to tell you right now, deception will work in your life, and you won't even know. You won't even know that you deceived. So the most important thing, look, we've got the Holy Ghost who's come here to lead us and guide us in all truth. We got his protection, his provision. We've got everything that we have need of. Father is taking care of us. Christ Jesus taking interceding for us. All we've got to have is a right heart. All we got to do is have a childlike heart and just obey God and do what God says every time. Every time. Why do I do it every time? I'll obey. Is it okay if I obey 90% of the time? No, obey every time. When the man of God is declaring the word of God to you, you obey. It doesn't matter what it is. I have never gone to people and say, listen, I want you to come to my house and I want you to change the light bulb in my bathroom. However, I know of preachers who have, and the person came, changed the light bulb, and the power of God came upon them, and they're changed forever in their life. It was changed. Everything about their life was changed because they simply obeyed. They became a servant. And I'm certain that the man of God was actually telling a person that right out of the realms of spirit, come to my house, fix my light bulb in my bathroom. And while you're there, shine my shoes. Well, you know, Pastor, I'd really like to do that, but I'm really busy. You know, I got my own light bulb to change, my own shoes to shine. And besides that, come on, man. Why don't you just hire somebody because my time is valuable? That person's going to walk away wondering why it is that they've done so much and labored so hard, but nothing's really changed. Obey God. Be like a little child. Obey God. And, you know, when we begin to give ourselves over, you know, we've been ministering on that place of being rooted and grounded in love, just giving yourself that place of divine love, that same love that Jesus showed us, that same love the Father has, participating with that love that has been poured in our heart by the Holy Ghost. That love is a great motivator. There's just so much love there that you become the servant of all. You're happy. You're happy to do it. You know, I can tell you right now, I can go through the list. Most people, when you meet them quickly, you can find out how many people are going to actually come over, change your light bulb, shine your shoes. You know. You don't even have to test it out. You know. And then you really recognize, well, it's not that anybody's getting written off here. We just know that some things that have got to be changed. Not that I want anybody to change my light bulbs, although they need to be changed. Nor do I want anybody to shine my shoes, even though they need to be shined. It's not about that. It's about you coming to a place in your life where there is working within your heart a servitude and a submission to God, which would be expressed in those other things too. A yieldedness to Him, a surrender to Him, where you're holding nothing back. People want God to give them everything, but yet they're holding their own life back from Him. That's not what the Holy Ghost is teaching us. He's teaching us to surrender everything about our life, to hold nothing back. He's teaching us about allowing God to just fill us completely with Him, because we're empty and devoid of anything else that we potentially would try to hang on to. It's good to see you, man. We let go of everything that would be about us, because we want Him. I want Him. Amen. And then the Lord, when that state, the Lord comes along and He makes adjustments. He says, no. He says, you're not being successful in that. And let me tell you why. And He doesn't say, because I don't know how to do calculus. He doesn't say, because I don't know, understand these great mysteries. He doesn't say, because I don't understand ancient Assyrian history, or I don't understand the chronology of the Bible. He just simply tells me, because I'm doing it on my own and not trusting Him. That's all. Almost every situation would be, it's almost like a recording. You're doing it on your own and you're not trusting me. All I want to do is I want to teach you to follow me. Let me lead you. Let me inspire you. Now, God, if you give yourself over to the Holy Ghost, you know, one of the things that I get so excited about are those times when I'm a bit overwhelmed with things, and I'm maybe just really tired or worn out, just don't even have the strength hardly to keep my eyes open, but I got to keep my eyes open. And the Holy Ghost comes upon me like a rushing mighty wind. And He's just busting out of my innermost being. I can't shut the basta down. And before it's all over, I feel so strong and I feel so refreshed. And I didn't even ask Him. And it wasn't like I even volunteered. It was like involuntarily. God, the Holy Ghost came because I've given myself over to His control and His mastery. And He came and just miraculously produced within something inside of me that was so outside of me, so beyond me, so nothing of me. Hallelujah. It's such the miracle. I mean, you could just stand back and just revel in the miracle of the Holy Ghost. And a big part of the school of the Spirit and walking with Him is He's just looking. He's saying, are you really willing to give me over your whole will? Because He's not going to violate our will. But if we're really willing to give over our whole will, then He will cause us or make us to walk in His statutes. When our will is so just given over, and that's by crossroad after crossroad, event after event, because our spirit, the spirit that is in man. See, you know, Jesus said to the disciples, he said, watch and pray so that you don't enter into temptation. Their eyes are too heavy to watch and pray. Their eyes are too heavy to watch and pray. Because He says to them, your spirit is willing. Back there at communion, you guys were all rallying. We're dying with you. And they all said it. Though they kill us, we're standing beside your side. They're all excited. They're in the prayer meeting. The power of God's moving. They're rolling on the floor laughing. And woo! But then they get themselves in the situation. And now they're all nodding off. He says, the Spirit's willing. Their spirit was willing. But their human ability waned. It was weak. Well, here's now another dynamic. Woo! Because we got something new. Now our spirit is willing. And now we got Holy Ghost that moves in to that willing spirit and produces an overriding supernatural ability and strength to do it. I mean, come on, man. This is an amazing 3 hand claps, 5 frowns, and 10 smiles. I mean, come on, man. This has got to become an explosion on the inside of you. It really does. It really does. Your faith will never move beyond your confession, holding forth your confession without wavering. You will never begin to move into such proclamation until an excitement hits you about the Word of God. I'm telling you, when I read the Bible, still hair on the back of my neck stands up when I read about the miracles of Jesus, when I see Him walking on the water. I'm excited about it. There's a living power of God resident in my being. Father, how's that for you? Somebody said, what's wrong with me? I really don't know. We'll have to look a little closer. But it's probably that yourself rules you more than the Holy Ghost does. It's probably that your own interest has more impact on you than the divine interest. And if you'll just begin to make the transition and say, okay, God, all that I have is yours. Wouldn't you like to be able to say to the man sitting at the gate called Beautiful, rise up and walk? Well, you're going to have to come to the place of saying, silver and gold have I none. I've given it all into the kingdom, but such as I have, give I thee. Where it's no longer about you. It's about heaven. It's about His divine power and glory. Where you're no longer living for yourself. Because I'm going to tell you right now, 1 second after you're dying, after you die, you are going to abhor every moment you live for yourself. You will abhor it. And the more you give yourself over to the Spirit of the living God, to the moving of the Holy Ghost, you can abhor it now. Amen. And it becomes profane to you and you don't want it. I don't want this stuff in my life. Hallelujah. 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 His manifest presence. You know, I love the manifest presence. I've discovered you don't ever have to be without it. But you know what? If I don't have the manifest presence of God, I'm still obey the Word. Hallelujah. I'm going to obey the Word of God. I mean, if you're super tired and all of a sudden you begin to feel like you're coming down with some kind of sickness or disease, you know what I'm saying? You're in pain, you're achy. You don't really feel the manifest presence of God. You with me? Hallelujah. But I can obey the Word of God. And I can say, I can stand up and say, let not the inhabitants of the Lord say I'm sick. By your stripes I've been healed. Sickness hath no hold on me. Healing is the children's bread. I'm going to obey God. Hallelujah. You with me? I love how Smith Wigglesworth is quoted that, or said that Smith Wigglesworth said it. I don't ask myself how I feel. I tell myself how I feel. I'm obeying the Word of God. You understand? I'm putting God not out there on just some kind of memory verse level. Some kind of demonstration only within the context of the church meeting. I'm putting Him at that place where it's the living Word working on the inside of me, and I demand that reality. That's the school of the Spirit. That's what God the Holy Ghost is doing. God the Holy Spirit is leading and guiding us into all truth. He wants to teach us to function and operate in truth. The truth is the Word of God, the living Word, Christ Jesus, and the written Word, the Bible that we read. And we just got to begin to produce. We just got to begin to do it. If we don't do it, we'll never have it. It's all about doing. It's not about hearing. People think it's about hearing. It's about the multitude of hearing. It's about the doing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it's just simply recognizing that it's available. If someone else couldn't do it, look at this man. What does Jesus say? Yeah, you did good. You did good, John. That's right. Man, he's not coming to our church. Shut him down. No, he said, no, man. He says, forbid him not. He's still saying that today. Is anybody going to start moving around here? Is anybody going to start casting out devils in my name? And the Lord's not going to go, oh, no, you're heading out. You're going out beyond your anointing. What do you mean? This is Shabrabataya. Jesus was manifested. I mean, he shakes with an intensity. The whole will of the Father is about you and I laying hold of and receiving that which He's freely given, which He wants every one of us to function in. He's looking with anticipation when we're going to move outside of ourselves, outside of our human constraint, outside of our fears, outside of our self-consciousness, outside of our intimidation, our self-interest, and just start doing what He said to do with total abandonment. You see somebody sick and hurting, stop them right wherever they are and say, listen, I want to pray for you. God's going to heal you right now. Pray the prayer of faith. No, people say, no, how are they going to receive it? So I might think I'm attacking them, trying to steal their purse. All the other imaginations that Satan's going to throw at you. Who knows what he's going to come up with? Because all of them are stupid. And the sad thing is that somebody's listening. You know, we're going to start exalting God's word. Just do what he said to the 12, what he said to the 70. He's saying to you and me what he said to the 12, what he said to the 70 when he sent them out. He said, freely you've received. He didn't say you earned it. They earned it. You know, heavy eyes kid, you know, 3 years of training, all they can do with the greatest crisis in the ministry of Jesus. He's saying, please, can you just with 1 hour, just for 1 hour, I've been up all day and night with you guys for 3 years. Can you give me 1 hour? Three times. It's like the third time, he's like, I'm not even saying nothing. He said, dude, he can't do it three times. The third time, he said nothing. They were all asleep. He says, Peter, come on, man. You're the big guy here. Can't you get up? Can't you watch with me for 1 hour? Don't you understand the crisis that I'm in? This is the second plea. Huh? Come on, man. Come on. Yes. If those kind of folks can do this stuff, what can you and I do? Amen. How about that, I say? I mean, is there anybody in here who could have stayed awake 1 hour with Jesus? Good. Glad to see that. Praise God. Amen. Amen. And of course, Peter was more boisterous about it than anybody here. I'm certain that if Peter had been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, it would have been another dynamic. Because we see him fearful and intimidated with all the rest and unbelieving. You know, Mary Magdalene comes in, says, I've seen Jesus. And they look at her like, you, she's lost her mind. She's stricken with grief. Brilliant, well-trained apostles. 500, watch them go up into heaven. See the glory. 120 make it to the upper room. Out of the 120, three shine with radiant glory. Three shine with radiant glory of the 120. Peter, John, and James shine with radiant glory. James was so radical, they had to get rid of him quick, man, because he took right up where Jesus left off. Three out of 120. 500, reduced to 120. 120, almost reduced to three. Not to say that all the rest of them didn't do something. Hey, you know, Philip, we only get one great splash on Philip. But we know that he was still moving in the things of God because he raised up four daughters who prophesied. Yes. So I don't know what the Lord did with him, whether the Lord made him a pastor or what happened. And he just sat down in a community and began to train people and teach people and see the church become established. I don't really know. I'll know one day. But the bottom line of it is there could be a whole lot more people impacted by the glory of God moving on. I'm not going to stop preaching it. I'm not going to stop pushing and shoving and blowing the trumpet and screaming in people's ears and saying, wake up. Somebody said, if you would just tone down, well, more of us could tolerate you and, you know, we wouldn't be so offended and upset and we wouldn't feel so, you know, we wouldn't feel so scared to bring people. You feel the same way about Jesus' ministry. I got Jesus' ministry. Amen. Yeah, you with me? The power of the Holy Ghost is what the world is in need of. Eh? Power of the Holy Ghost. It's Troy, right? Tori. I get it right. I was back and forth between the O and the R. Tori was sharing with me, she got baptized in the Holy Ghost just recently. But been around church for a long time and just, you know, just saying how this short interval of time has been over the top. And it really is. She's so full of the glory of God. I mean, you're so different from what you were, what was it, 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago? I stepped right over here, I started praying for Allie. You felt the anointing and came grab me, said, I need help. And look at you, just full of the glory. I'm going to tell you right now, there at this very moment in time, hundreds of thousands of people right here in this region who are so desperate It's so desperate. And we're so, and if we're not careful, we'll be so busy with other things, we won't come sit at his feet and be taught of God and know how to move. Because Satan's got a great strategy set up, you know, and that is to get everybody so preoccupied with taking care of the things that they need to take care of that the laborers are that much more fewer. The Lord's always had a human resource crisis. He has. The laborers have been few. Huh? Satan was walking up and down to and fro throughout all the earth and comes with the innuendo that everybody's serving him. God's got one. Human resource limited. Huh? The whole world has gone to wickedness. God's got eight. Right? Noah and his three sons and their wives. Noah, his wife, his three sons and their wives. That's father's success. He must not be very anointed. Got three, eight people in his church. Then he got reduced down to one by the time Job comes along. Huh? Jesus built it up to well over a couple hundred, 200 or so, follow him around. Then he preached his Sunday morning service. Everybody left. It was down to 12 again. It was the eat my flesh and drink my blood meeting. And you guys didn't come here because you're hungry for God. You just want to be fed. Your stomach's growling. All you want's food. Just let somebody start talking to you about like that. Huh? If there's any pride in you, any rebellion in you, it's going to come out with horns. Amen. And hooves. And the hood's going to send you running. You know what I'm saying? You put yourself there. I put myself there. I said, I've asked myself, could I have taken it? And I'm like, yes, I could, because this is my disposition. It's my heart. You can't insult me. The Syrophoenician woman, she couldn't be insulted. It's easy for her to get what God has for her. Huh?
Yeah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Elisha couldn't be insulted. It's easy for him to get what God has for him.
Right.
Huh?
Yeah.
Somebody said, you talk to me like that, and well, we understand. That's exactly why you are the way you are. That's the way it is. You have to understand. That thing needs to be fixed in you.
Right.
Salvation was supposed to fix it. The new heart, the new creation was supposed to fix it, but somehow you let it back in. You allowed your former conversation, the former influences, former disposition, former realm of thinking to come back in. And you know, that can happen on every level. It can happen on a level emotionally, physically, spiritually. It can happen on every level. But, you know, if it's very overt, some kind of lust of the flesh, most of the time people recognize that's sin. He's trying to come back into my life and take domination. And we repent and we set it away. But when it comes to the areas of the pride of life, it's so subtle. It's so subtle that we can actually, we can spiritualize it. We can normalize it. We can justify it and make it a reasonable behavior in our life. When it's just simply the pride of life, which is as bad as the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. Because we've not learned how to step over into the places in God that would have protected us. You know the two places, the two greatest places of protection against the pride of life? The love of God and humility. Walking in love, being clothed with humility. The pride of life can't even get you. You're untouchable. It's a shield. It's the glory. Hallelujah. It's given myself to walk in. Jesus said, John 13, 35, because of this love, the same love that I loved you, you love one another with the same love that I've loved you with. And so we got to understand clearly what that kind of love is. That means I'm going to do more than come over and change your light bulbs and shine your shoes. I'm going to go die for you.
Amen.
Or hello.
Yeah.
There's no, I mean, I'll give my whole life for you. You know, forget about any other kinds of limitation. When you're willing to give your whole life, my goodness, everything else is nothing. Are you with me? And then we're willing to be clothed with humility, understanding that God has called me in the school of the Spirit to learn how to so submit myself. Hallelujah. To not do it my own way, walk in my own imaginations. Listen to me. God told the prophet, he said, listen, you go, you do what I said, you return, you speak to no one on the way, you speak to no one when you're returning, obey me. God had a great plan for the prophet. The prophet's on the way back. Another prophet comes out and says, I too am a prophet. Listen to me. Turn aside. That's it. It's over. Taken out. Eaten by a lion. Taken out by a prophet who wants to impose His word upon that direction which the Lord had already established. You've got to be careful, people. I'm telling you right now. We learn how to, God's taught us to come, called us to come fundamentally with a loud voice. Come and learn of me. Come, I want you to be taught lowliness and meekness. I want you to get yourself over here, and I want you to learn how to be the bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to learn how to begin to function in the local church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to learn how to begin to serve. Yeah. Give me a break, people.
Amen.
There's so many opportunities in God that you don't have to look around.
Yeah.
Huh? There's plenty of berries to pick. There's plenty of work to be done. There's plenty of things to do in the Spirit. Hallelujah. There's plenty of heavenly vision. I personally believe that what God, that a large part of what Father has purposed to do is events once again in Southern California. You just imagine, I know that people sitting out in, you know, Tucumcari, Arizona, believe that the move of God's going to start there. And I'm happy for that. You know, Timbuktu nowhere over in Kalamazoo, California. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Up in Hesperia. You know, wherever. Everybody can believe that. But you know what? There are certain strategic events and strongholds. And you see those things brought down. And suddenly, there is a great outpouring. I believe that there is a great thing that God is going to do in Southern California. That's why... One of the reasons, I mean, I go to different places in the earth, and the Lord said, return to Southern California. You know what? I've prayed so many times, so much of my life, Lord, I want to be right in the center of your great outpourings and your great explosions. I'm going to make sure that I recognize that Father is going to hear my prayer and answer my prayer. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that, you know, I'm going to submit myself to Him. I'm going to trust Him absolutely, and I'm going to walk steadily, patiently, and consistently with Him, and fearfully with Him, one step at a time. And when I have such a state of my heart, I'm going to be obedient.
Amen.
I'm going to walk in love. I'm going to be clothed with humility. I'm going to be anxious about learning a greater depth of meekness and a greater depth of lowliness. Hallelujah.
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 Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
So, you know, in the school of the Spirit, just understand the most important thing, once again, is your willingness to love and covet and desire the things that God has for you. And see that is more important to yourself than anything else. And if it's not, there's something wrong spiritually. The Spirit of the Son has that attitude. And God has put the Spirit of the Son on the inside of us. And then simply do it. Simply do it. He says, freely receive, freely give. I mean, you don't even have to be specially anointed and separated as 12 apostles. All you have to do is be a bystander that saw it happen and then said, that is so amazing. I'm going to go do it too. And goes and cast out devils in the name of Jesus. Start doing it. You've been given a license. You've been given authority. You've been given power. Just be simple about it. Don't get all flaky and weird and freaky about the whole thing. Just do it. Hallelujah. When the knife is sharp, you don't have to cut hard. Hallelujah. It's an old rabbinic saying. When the knife is sharp, you don't have to cut hard. You don't have to stand there and woo, 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 do a dance and grab people and shake them, pull their ears, and just in Jesus' name, be healed in Jesus' mighty name. I've never found anybody who refused to be a blessing. You just see, the hardest person, I won't bless you. Hallelujah. I bless you right now in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
What are they going to do? I got it in before you can say anything about it.
Right.
And it's life-giving, and it's power. It's power. It's like most people out there have already heard the Bible preached. They've heard everything. They've watched so many TV preachers. They've heard so much gospel. Man, but as soon as somebody with an anointing of the Holy Ghost in life say, I bless you right now in the name of Jesus, it shakes them down. The very spirit starts going. It does, man. Spirit of the Lord is right there hovering over top of them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, it's part of, it's the fundamentals of my theology. In the beginning, God created. He's the creator. And immediately, see, I see something, another dimension about God. I see that there's the Spirit of God who now hovers over to bring forth that which God is longing to produce. I still see the same thing. He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. Look at somebody, see the Holy Ghost hovering over them. All I got to do is speak the word. Boom, congeals. God creates. They can act like nothing happened, and I know they're shaking on the inside. Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. We want you to know that too. We want you to start simply obeying God. Quit making some big deal out of this thing. If you're having to cut so hard, go and sharpen your knife in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise God. This should be easy. Amen. It should be fun. Hallelujah. It's a blessing to see people sick and diseased and hurting and in pain, and then you pray for them, they feel good. And no price tag. No price tag. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And then the Lord says, not only to the 12, not only to the 70, but He says, these signs should follow them to believe. These miracles will be in your life. And you see fundamentally that the Lord is there, and I'm not going to go in this tonight. I'll talk about it later. Because I'm going to do a School of Spirit again next Friday. But he the first fundamental thing that we see the Lord Jesus doing is focusing on our authority over unclean spirits to cast them out. Our authority over devils. Our authority over the powers of darkness. That's the first and foremost. Why? Because if you're going to spoil the house, you must bind a strong man. And you don't have to do no great intercession to do it. It's the authority of the Word. I give you authority to cast out devils. Now, let me understand. I'm going to talk about this more next Saturday. If you allow demon spirits to have activity in your life, you have no power over them, or you have very little power. Because they're going to take your confidence, they're going to take your boldness, they're going to take your courageousness, they're going to take the certainty of your relationship, your position before the Father. They're going to constantly be attacking that. They're going to constantly try to create a greater breach, greater distance. Because moving in this is a boldness. It's a confidence. It's a certainty. I can do this. I've got a license. I have the authority of the Son. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have the authority of the Son. As a son, I have the authority of the Son. And that's what John was saying. As many believe, those who would receive, because you can't just believe, you got to be able to receive too. Hallelujah. It's not just believing, it's receiving. And I like to deal more than anything else as a pastor, the things that keep people from receiving. And that's why I'll come at it. I'll come at it with a sword. I'll start poking it. I'll start pressing every button. You know when something's not working right, you know what you start doing? You start pressing all the buttons, turning all the knobs. Right? Ripping all the switches until you get yourself a response. And then people go, man, he's pushing every one of my buttons intentionally. I'm trying to find out why you ain't working, man. Hallelujah. I want to see what makes you real mad. You know what we're doing? Calling that demon to manifest. It's true. We'll open you like a can. A pork and beans. We'll open you up like a can. We'll see what's on the inside there. Hello. Things start poking out. I know one guy was reading the Riot Act one night to the congregation. A lot of preachers there, just reading the Riot Act. He was just up and down. He was pushing every button, flipping every switch. And it got to a place that one of the preachers on the second row, literally like a dog, not with his hands, but reached out with his head and tried to bite him. Wow. Now it's time to cast that devil out. Hallelujah. Hastakeya. Beristanekiapa. You cannot fundamentally minister the gospel without authority over unclean spirits. And thus you don't want any demon spirits to be able to have access to your mind. If a demon spirit can affect your attitude, you under its power, you're oppressed by it. You hear me?
Yes.
If a demon spirit can affect your emotions, You're under an oppressive evil thing. You want to learn quickly how to shut that down. And you got great weapons. Amen. Weapons are warfare, not carnal, but they're mighty. Can you name the weapons to me?
Yes.
Huh? Name them.
The word, the authority of Jesus' name, the authority of God.
No, okay, but just the three that I gave you, because they're right. Yeah, because it's the authority. You got the word of God.
Yes.
The word.
Spirit.
It's a sword. Hello. It's not for, that's for taking hits, not for slicing bread.
Right.
You got that? Keep that in mind.
Yeah.
You speak the word.
Yes.
I speak the word over the thing.
Yeah.
Prophesying over yourself. Declare the word of God. Don't declare your own word.
Yeah.
Your own word ain't going to do nothing.
Amen.
Your own word can't create one blade of grass. Your word cannot create one drop of water. His word framed the universe.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Speak his word. Hello.
Hallelujah.
Don't speak your word. Prayer, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's prayer. Build yourself up. It's strengthening power. Hallelujah. Mondoste. Two great weapons. I don't want you to forget them. Your weapons. The great weapon, the name of Jesus. He gives us the authority to cast out devils in his name. We saw one casting out devils in your name. We want you to get, if I can get people, it's like when Joshua and Allie, I was so blessed that they were just hooked up with me because, you know, when you go through that kind of crisis and that's like high level stuff, that's like raising the dead stuff, okay? And we're with Anna and it's like, Joshua and Allie, just plaster the name of Jesus everywhere. Don't be ashamed of the name of Jesus. Let's put the name of Jesus everything on everything. Lift his name up because there's the authority. There is the power. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the authority of the blood. Do you know about the authority of the blood of the cross? You ever read about the blood of the cross? How many of you know about the blood of the cross? You read about the blood of the cross. Woo! My. He spoiled. He spoiled. He paralyzed, knocked out, KO'd. Amen. Huh? Paralyzed. Paralyzed from their eyebrows down.
Yeah.
Principalities and powers. That's that spoiled word. Paralyzed from the eyebrows down. Hallelujah. Praise God. The blood of the cross. Hallelujah. Mangea puina shiapa. Well, I'm going to save that for Sunday night.
I got about
arsenal full of messages on the communion table. I'm just so blessed and excited about having been released. You know, to be in our third night on it, this Sunday night. You don't miss Sunday night.
No.
You know, there's so many things about, you know, the subject of eating, drinking it anew in the eternal kingdom, the supper of the Lamb. I mean, just, you know, hallelujah. I've been preaching for more than 34 years. Hallelujah. The Lord has filled our hearts. I mean, really, there's so much to preach about. We could preach on another topic, a different topic, a new topic every night. Somebody says, why do you constantly preach the same thing then? Because that's what you got to hear. Because you don't get to move forward. No sense in having a vast knowledge of basis of information. No sense in it. Until you just start doing the fundamental things that God's given you to do. Huh?
Yes.
No sense in it. What are you going to do with all that information? Huh? You'd be so confused after all that information, you won't know where to start. Right? Whereas the one man who we don't even know his name just saw one of the disciples cast out a devil in the name of Jesus, imitate him, got the same results.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, amen.
Amen.
You have an authority. You have the Spirit of the Son on the inside of you crying, Abba, Father. Then you have Christ Jesus interceding for you. You have the Holy Ghost. There's a fire about you, far greater than a hedge. They're standing with you. All heaven's mobilized. I mean, look, Jesus could have called 12 legions. Somebody said, how many is a legion? Depends on what area of Rome you were in. Could have been 3,000, 4,200, 6,400. So when somebody asks me how many a legion is, I always kind of look at them cross-eyed going, what are we talking about? Which state? Which region? He could have called 12 legions of angels. Let's put it at the high level, 6,200. Woo! And it would have only taken one.
Right.
It only taken one. So he said, well, one was able to destroy more than 100,000. I'll tell you right now, he could have done a whole lot more than that. Huh? He wasn't trying. He was just standing there. And you think about you and me and our relationship with Father, because Jesus gave us the same relationship that he has with the Father. Woo! Father loves you just like he loves me. Walk in my love. I can call 12 legions. Praise God. I can call 12. I can call on the Father, ask for 12 legions. Hallelujah. I was reading this morning Psalms 89. God said, I'll decimate your enemies. Hallelujah. It will never be broken. I stand by this for the rest of eternity. I mean, read it. Especially those last few verses of Psalms 89. Hallelujah. Katorenea. If you'll just wake up every morning just so desperate, oh God, speak to me, oh God, speak to me, God, speak to me, Lord, I want to hear your voice. And you just keep going at that, you're going to find out God talk to you. Sometimes I'll open up every Bible. I'm going to tell you a secret. Sometimes I like to open up every Bible in the house, oh God, talk to me. Go open up another Bible, just open up one that's just for Psalms. God, speak to me, Lord, speak to me. Hallelujah. Speak to me, God. Hallelujah. This is searching. The seeking. Huh? Looking. Crying. The heart. Just do it. Just do it. Please just do it. I'm telling you, this you miss out on some of the great advances in God because you overlook how simple it is. You make it too complicated. It is so easy. Just like a little child. Just begin to receive. Hallelujah. And as you just receive as a little child, anyone that is sent in my name, you're receiving me. And you receive, when you receive me, you receive my Father. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. I got so many more things to say, but I'm just going to leave it there. You know what I like to do? I like to preach until at least two or three people are flowing in the Holy Ghost. I really like to preach and minister till everybody's flowing in the Holy Ghost. I'm just kidding, you know. No, I look at Cornelius' house and I get all jealous and provoked. Oh, God, Peter looks like he preached 5 minutes and the whole place is baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. But they were full of faith. They knew they had the right preacher in front of them because the angel said so. So there was a connection being made. Amen. Well, praise the name of Jesus. We love every one of you. Walk in love. Be clothed with humility. Understand that one of the most important things the Holy Spirit wants to teach you, and it's a hard lesson, it's hard. This isn't going to come easy for most people. He wants to teach you meekness and loneliness. He wants to show you the value of it. It's greater than in the value of all other things. Don't forget the meek will inherit the earth, despite what all the warmongers say. Huh? Despite what all the people need to go get a gun, carry a gun around. Put up your gun. They that live by the gun should die by the gun. Come on, people. We can stop whole armies with a word. Let's have the weapons Elijah had. All the great nations and powerful nations of the world were scared of him. Let's have the weapon Moses had. He conquered the empire of the world. Huh? And he didn't even need the stick. He didn't need the stick. Hallelujah. Come on, people. Let's go with the models of faith. Let's go with the examples of faith. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. If I'm going to tell you right now, if I'm not speaking the word, don't listen to me. Anyone who's not speaking the word, don't listen to them. Look, I'm earnest. I'm earnest about the move of God. I'm going to be where the move of God is. I'm earnest about the things of the Spirit. You're not going to find me just hanging out doing something else. I'm going to be right in the big middle of where it's at. You can believe that, whatever you want to do. It's fine. Everybody gets to decide for themselves what they want to do with their life. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be right where God is moving, right where he's speaking, right where he's forming, right where he's shaping. And I want every person in here to recognize, don't get discouraged. Patience will have her perfect work. You let her have her perfect work. Okay? That doesn't slow you up one little bit. But God is going to prepare you unto every good work. He's going to prepare you. You're going to be trained. You're going to be shaped. You're going to be formed. Fine. Be encouraged the whole time. Amen. Just lay hands on more people. Amen. Just prophesy over more situations and more people. Learn not to don't learn to prophesy out of your own thinking, out of your own impressions. Learn to let that flow get built up in you to where it's just a shout. It's a shout out. Hallelujah. And you can have revival meetings. You can have the move of God meetings in your life every day. If you'll give yourself to it, that word of authority will get strong. The knife will get sharp, and you won't have to cut so hard. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, thank you, Lord Jesus.